God's Not Dead and God's Not Dead 2 are 2014 and 2016 films, respectively, both directed by Harold Cronk. The first is a series of interconnected stories, with its central focus being an antagonistic classroom debate about the existence of God. The second centers around a teacher who answers a question about Jesus Christ in her public school history class and faces legal consequences for her actions. Both are what have been popularly called Christian exploitation films. In terms of their marketing, and in terms of their philosophy, they could be called Christian apologetics films. I don't care to try to convince anyone that there is or is not a God, but because that is the subject of these films, the debates contained within said films will be the subject of this episode. If you do not want to hear someone talk about God, I will not be offended if you turn back now. In the first film, Josh, a college freshman and Christian, takes an introductory to philosophy course taught by Professor Radisson. The professor is an atheist straw man, a scene-chewing caricature of an intellectual. In fairness, there are plenty of films that mischaracterize Christians as naive hicks, but that does not make this depiction any more noble. Radisson demands that his class write, "God is dead," on a piece of paper, but Josh refuses. Radisson challenges Josh to a debate about the existence of God. This will span the first few class sessions. Josh accepts. He confers with Pastor Dave, played by David A.R. White, the co-founder of the film's distributor, PureFlix. Pastor Dave asks Josh whether or not any of the approximately 80 classmates taking Radisson's course would ever step foot in a church. Josh says none of them. That is preposterous. America is a country in which Christianity is the predominant religion. A Gallup poll from 2014 puts Christians as 70% of America, but other polls put the figure as high as 83%. Even going by the low, conservative estimate, the idea that Josh is the only Christian or even devout Christian out of 80 people is extremely unlikely. Only a small fraction of America call themselves atheists. This plays into the film's bizarre, frankly ignorant portrayal of Christianity as a subjugated minority. Keep this in mind as it will become important later. Josh makes the argument that scientific theories about the beginning of the universe, like the Big Bang, do not disprove God. In and of itself, that is not a terrible statement to make. The Big Bang theory and the concept of a creator of the universe are not necessarily mutually exclusive. Believing in observable data does not automatically disprove God, and the two need not always be in conflict. Only fundamentalists and literalists are so aggressive towards science, and most Christians are not. These things are critical to understand. However, where Josh goes off the rails is where he claims that the Big Bang not only does not disprove God, but is actually evidence that God exists. "Let there be light," God says in the book of Genesis. And Josh claims that an explosion in space before anything else existed would resemble such light. But he neglects to mention two verses before "let there be light." Genesis actually begins, obviously, with verse 1 saying that God created the heavens and the earth, and verse 2 says that earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. So, no, Josh. Science does not say there were oceans before the Big Bang, only in the Bible. And since Josh takes a highly literal interpretation of the events of the Bible, he has boxed himself in, and his argument has fallen apart. Again, believing in a creator of the universe does not exclude accepting aspects of the Big Bang, but to say that the Big Bang is evidence of the literal word of God is not accurate and cherry-picks passages while ignoring others. In other words, God's Not Dead is a film that showcases the field of Christian apologetics. This is an area of theology that attempts to rationalize Christian faith and also defend Christianity from arguments and objections. While Christian apologetics takes many forms, the scientific subsection showcased in this film is actually the most problematic. For a film that tries to prove the existence of God, it chose the path of most resistance. In Christian scientific apologetics, an apologist will show some data that may bolster the claim based on, if we're being honest here, limited physical evidence of the Christian God, but largely ignore the basic argument that incredible claims require an incredible amount of evidence. Using Christian scientific apologetics the way Josh does in the film often runs into this problem. Christian apologetics works better under the subsection of philosophical apologetics, mostly because it is more abstract and therefore harder to disprove. One tenet is that the very concept of God prevalent in so many cultures that had no contact with one another suggests that there may be such a being. That is not to say that this is a completely convincing argument, but it's a lot harder to argue against than the pseudoscience that Josh brings up in his classroom argument. I am not making the claim that discussing the existence or non-existence of God is meaningless, but I am making the claim that we need not be so aggressive about it or defensive towards someone with an opposing view. Believing in God in and of itself does not make someone a good person. Disbelieving in God in and of itself does not make someone a bad person, and vice versa. What is troubling is that God's Not Dead does make the claim that without God, there is no reason to be moral. Actual line from the film. That is not only flawed logically, but also deeply frightening. We, as human beings, do not need to be rewarded in order to treat each other with respect and empathy. A good-hearted Christian would not suddenly become vile and mean-spirited if they stopped believing in God. The implications of such an assertion are staggering, dangerous, and insulting, not only to secular people, but to the faithful, and this film recklessly says this. Josh claims that without the concept of God, there would be no standard of morality. Here's the thing. Even with the concept of God, there is no standard of morality today, and never has been. Not only because not everyone believes in God, but because there have been countless religious faiths over human history, some probably never even recorded. Even if the world only had two faiths, there still would be no agreed-upon standard of morality. Even within Christianity, there are so many different denominations. Also, there exists non-theistic standards of morality, like consequentialism, a doctrine that states that the morality of an action is to be judged solely by its consequences, not to mention secular humanism. Again, I am not trying to stoke controversy and say that one is inherently better than another, but Josh's assertion is that without God, specifically his version of God, there is no point in trying to behave under some code of morality is laughable at best and alarming at its worst. And he's our hero in this movie. Furthermore, when the film says God, it is definitely only referring to God as defined by Christianity alone. God's Not Dead displays disgusting and unambiguous Islamophobia. Aisha secretly wants to convert from Islam to Christianity, and then her father beats her up and kicks her out of her home. The film callously treats people who are not Christian with antipathy, giving a liberal secular journalist cancer, killing off Professor Radisson in a car accident, and then in the most revolting moment of the film, the two pastors celebrate this because, even though he died painfully, he also fearfully converted to Christianity while blood filled up his lungs.
What happened here tonight is a cause for celebration.
God's Not Dead furthers the myth that atheists and other secular people are who they are because of some tragedy that made them stop believing. It's actually a common trope in film, and typically used as an obstacle for someone to overcome, as if not being religious in and of itself is a personal failing that must be eradicated. The film also pushes the lie that atheists actually just hate God instead of disbelieving. Oh, you don't believe in my deity? Then you must hate my deity. It's not even remotely the same thing, and it is deeply insulting. God's Not Dead 2 is about a teacher named Grace. A student asks her about a parallel between the nonviolence of Martin Luther King Jr. and Jesus Christ. The teacher carefully explains that yes, Christ did teach nonviolence. There's an uproar about this, and the God's Not Dead universe's version of the ACLU convinces the parent of the student to take Grace to court. In the first film, our straw man was an atheist professor, but in the sequel, the series ups the ante and gives us Peter Cain, whose last name may be a reference to the biblical first murderer. Ray Wise is a fine actor, but his role in this film is deeply troubling as an overtly Christian-hating lawyer. Resistance and hatred of the American Civil Liberties Union is common among the far right, but not because the ACLU fights against religion. but because it believes that the Constitution of the United States of America protects the religious from persecution, but also protects people persecuted by religion. It's a two-way street. The First Amendment provides these dual protections, encouraging religious liberty and safeguarding both religion and government from the influences of the other. Pastor Dave and his colleagues are shocked to hear that the government may subpoena their sermons. They reference that this actually nearly happened in Houston before the city backed down. But what they neglected to mention in this obviously anti-ACLU film is that the American Civil Liberties Union publicly denounced the subpoenas and would have undoubtedly offered support should it have gone forward. But this level of nuance is not part of the worldview of the God's Not Dead films, so the Peter Kane character instead froths at the mouth at Christianity and practically becomes aroused by the fact that he might strike a blow against Jesus Christ. With the almost ACLU as the second film's villain and a liberal blogger in the first film, the God's Not Dead films propagate the false notion that Christianity is a strictly conservative movement in America, and that liberals are solely the atheists and enemies of faith. In reality, polls show that the majority of Republicans, Democrats, and independent voters in my country believe in God, and that only a small minority from each category are determined atheists. But this false narrative plays out all the time, and not just in these films. Christianity is for everyone. A church is meant to be a sanctuary. Inclusive, not exclusive. The God's Not Dead films, especially Part 2, often come across as more political than spiritual.
I hate what people like your clients stand for, and what they're doing to our society.
The filmmakers who made God's Not Dead 1 and 2 insist an egregious level of anti-Christian, anti-God discrimination happens all the time in America. And to prove it, both films close with court cases allegedly backing up their claims. The implication is that these cases are much like the ones presented in the films, but actually none that we see at the end of God's Not Dead 2 dealt with a teacher on trial. Most were about students promoting faith to other students, which is not illegal, but many others were about some far-right Christian's desires to discriminate against gays. In fact, over a dozen of these cases deal with Christians discriminating against homosexuals, and over 20 were about healthcare and/or abortion. But of course, the film is not brave enough to showcase their antiquated discrimination or lead with something as controversial as reproductive rights. Instead, we see a woman who meant well and possibly did not do anything technically illegal as our protector of the Christian faith. And all the anti-gay cases that the filmmakers clearly love are shown at the end, so as not to arouse suspicion about the darker politics of this film series. Christians make up a majority in America and a plurality on Earth, and the vast majority of them are decent, reasonable, good-hearted people. But these films are not about them. These films preach to a smaller subset of less tolerant Christians who, because of their fringe beliefs that affirm that discriminating against homosexuals and others is acceptable, consider themselves to be a maligned minority. It's the old, tired exclamation of, "How dare you discriminate against my discrimination?" It's circular and meaningless. There is so much more to talk about with these movies. A Chinese immigrant converts to Christianity after maybe a few days in an American college. By the second film, he decides to become a missionary in China. But maybe I should sum up. So, who watches God's Not Dead 1 and 2? Who is the target demographic? These movies do not convert new Christians. I can't imagine being a secular person converted to Christianity through low-budget films with poorly executed stories, bad acting, and terrible messages. These movies do not strengthen the faith of most mainstream Christians, because most Christians I know would find either the wrong-headed ideas offensive or the implication that they themselves believe such things to be offensive. God's Not Dead 1 and 2 preach to a choir. The people who already have intolerant beliefs about discrimination in the guise of religious freedom. Confirmation bias of their own mistaken notions about the majority being the true subjugated. I hope the same is not true here, and that this episode reaches people who might not have immediately agreed with me even before hearing what I had to say. Because we can be better than this. atheists and theists should not adopt an us versus them mentality. That is ultimately self-defeating and benefits nobody. In fact, it helps develop the mistrust that allows these films to continue to preach their awful ideas, because if Christians and other theists see atheists and other secular people as hostile enemies, it is easier for fringe Christian preachers to falsely convince them that there is a war on religion. We have to be better than these movies. In short, God's Not Dead 1 and 2 are not just bad movies. They are bad for us. Thanks for your time. Thanks for watching the latest episode of Renegade Cut, everyone. If you want to support the show, you can click the orange link to my Patreon. That's how all of this happens. If you want to subscribe and never miss an episode, click on the red link. If you want to watch more, there are some recommended videos below. I'll see you next week for another episode.